Welcome, everybody, to the second of our science fiction meets architecture, London 2080, 65 years from now. As mentioned last time, our objective in these talks is to have a highly visual, structurally thinking, functionally thinking person think about the future and the way the dynamics of society then might affect the built environment. And at the same time, have another super expert in narrative and fictional thinking, science-based fictional thinking, display the way he, in this case, thinks of the future. Marjan Colletti is speaking on our side, and Vernor Vinge is speaking from California in San Diego at UCSD. It's being brought to us by the Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination and here through the Bartlett School of Architecture. I'll just say a few words about Marjan, who many of you probably know. He's an architect, an educator, and a design researcher. He does his research into architectural and cultural productions. Marjan was born in Italy. He's Italian, and he studied architecture first in Austria and then at the Bartlett here. He currently teaches in both places. Actually, you go back and forth every week, isn't that so? Yeah, that's a lot. He's director of computing at the Bartlett, and at Innsbruck, he's the head of the Institute for Experimental Architecture. I asked him what experimental architecture is and what he would say is its paramount goal, and he said, how to reboot architecture. That is, how to rethink form, performativity, stability versus mobility, presence, process of design, and the process of making. So I won't say more, because we're going to have a lovely time listening to both Marjan and Vernor.
David?
Maybe on this side, let me just get my introduction out of the way, and then we can get these two guys going, okay? Okay, as David said, it's welcome to Arthur C. Clarke Center for Human Imagination here and our connection with the Bartlett School of Architecture in London. Second of our first two of these, I want to thank David Kirsch, who's created this forum and brought it from concept to practice, and we hope that this gives us the basis of a further collaboration that we'll be doing in the future. And I just wanted to say a couple things about this theme of megamalls that we're doing this time. And it's a theme that in some ways is about as dystopian a term that I think can be used to consider the future of humanity's fate, and one that might even rival the human battery farms of the Matrix in terms of the kind of dehumanization of who we are. But I think if we're considering the future, that this gives us a particular focus of human activity that can attenuate our understanding of human interaction, how we organize public space, how we, when it becomes increasingly sentient and malleable, how our individual agency can be and how it will be negotiated and commoditized. And it's a site that has some precedence in terms of thinking about futurity. And is in his essay, Future City, the postmodern theorist Frederick Jameson posits the mall as a spatial and architectural manifestation of a range of issues, from globalization to metaphysics, when speculating about our own futures. And he kind of ends with this kind of comment that it's, and in some ways, when you're speculating about the future, it's easier to imagine the end of the world than to imagine the end of capitalism. And so here in San Diego, we have Vernor Vinge, who's going to be taking this issue on. Vernor is a Hugo Award-winning science fiction author whose books include Rainbow's End, a lot of which takes place on this campus and on this mesa, A Fire Upon the Deep, A Deepness in the Sky, amongst many others. And he's well known for his provocative 1993 essay, The Coming Technological Singularity, in which he argues that the creation of superhuman artificial intelligence will mark the point at which the human era has ended, and such that no current models of reality are sufficient to predict beyond that time. And in that essay, he says that within 30 years, we will have the technological means to create superhuman intelligence, and shortly after, the human era will have ended. So he wrote that in 1993, so we have 7 more years to enjoy. And this concept's been taken up by many people like Ray Kurzweil at Google and Peter Diamandis with kind of different notions about what the singularity might entail for us. So we have terrific people to kind of help us think about this future London 2080 and what our own fates might be. So take it away, London.
Thank you, San Diego. That's amazing. Thank you. Thank you, London. Thank you, San Diego. Hello, Vernor. It's a pleasure to meet you. What's going on? Please see another. I think it might take more than 7 years for machines to take over. This particular laptop is very embryonic, if that's the case. I think we lost you guys on the right side, or did you turn off the lights?
We see you.
It was just like an empty space. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction, for the possibility to talk here. I think I would say, it's quite challenging, first of all, to talk about this particular theme and also trying to answer your questions. I just told you it's big questions about what's main problems, who are you, what do you want to do, how can you change, what's the future, what's 2080. Interestingly, I don't think that architects we ask these questions to each other, so it's very healthy, but it's quite challenging. So, and I tried to think about this, and I don't think I've got definite answers, by far not. Actually, I probably show that we should enjoy being stupid for the next 7 years, and I'll be a paramount example of that. But just back to the introduction, if I ask to think about 2080, I have to put it into a slightly wider context. So it's about 64 years in the future. So I think it would be worthwhile looking at 64 years in the past just to see if a midway where it might go. We're certainly as architects, so I'm not the Delphi Oracle, as you can see here. I don't think any of these predictions will come true. And I put up a presentation that should be as an introduction then to Vernor's speak. About his thoughts. We had a quick change on Skype, and we decided that I was going to go first. Why do I show this one? Also, apart from being Italian, I was also educated in a humanistic gymnasium, with Greek and ancient Latin and ancient Greek and so on and so forth. So I think having been educated in such a way, just like listening to the introduction from San Diego, I find it quite challenging, actually, to think about a post-humanistic era. But nevertheless, let's move on. So what I'm going to talk today as an architect, and as a possible discipline that certainly contributes to a prediction or a discussion about the future of the planet. By no chance, I think in 1996, the Biennale in Venice, which is one of the main or the major gathering of architects and projects in the world, which was created in that year by Hans Holbein, had the title of Sensing the Future, the Architect's Seismograph. So surely I think there's an intrinsic awareness in the discipline for society and changes and technology implementation and so on and so forth. And so just looking at, for instance, a visual representation of the architect's seismograph, here's some projects from the 60s. On the left, mostly by Austrians. It's been mentioned that I studied there, so certainly this is part of my
pedigree in education, House Rucker Co. and Walter Pichler at the left, which designed these devices just to represent that at some point, in a sense, reading it as a project nowadays, it might be seen as the human being being interfaced with the world. And that was quite a prediction, you know, if you think that it was in the 60s. At the right, it's actually, it's happening, as you know, the 360 cam, and so it's a highly technological artifice or device. And then on the right, kind of a more fashion-driven, purely designed and a technological version, perhaps, of how we might look like differently. I want to put this as well, just to ridicule myself a priori, so that you're not going to take too seriously what I'm going to say. Anyhow, this is the first thing I did here at the Bartlett. It was a little bit a response to that. 19 years ago, so that's already looking back at who I was. 20 years ago, also a device that should comment on the professional architect or the architect as needing perhaps the aid of something else. Maybe it's technological, maybe it's not, to be aware of the environment. Having been asked to look at the future, 2080, I'll certainly be dead. And so I can look ahead maybe 20 years' time. So if you process your face in this particular software, which will need 20years.com, then it predicts how you might look like in 20 years' time, which is probably like that, hopefully. But then if you feed that image again, you can see that the system actually fails to, you know, to really envision what that might happen. So approaching 2080 again, so that's going to be 103. And I look like an Italian politician from 10, 15 years ago. But that's not the case. So I think, you know, the machine, in a sense, you know, I would like to exemplify, is not capable of predicting what I'll be in 2080. So moving on from there. Okay, here we go. Anyhow, so I said, like, this difficulty of predicting the future is actually something to worry about as an architect, because whatever you do, a project is a priori a projection of something into the future. We design things, we think about conditions, we think about processes, we think about inhabitations, we think about users, we think about environments that actually are not materialized yet. So whatever we do, and you can see it from the etymological root of project, is throwing something into the future. So it's a prediction, it's a foreseeing, a forecasting by default. And in that sense, you know, this kind of thing, I truly believe that architects should also be involved, as we are today, in this description of a potential future and scenario. Somebody is playing with the thing, but it doesn't matter. Shall I just continue? Okay, I think, yeah, I'll be ready now for the video. I'm just going to show.
Can you drive it, please?
And to understand somehow how I will approach the thing, I would like to quote or show this video by Philip Stark, which is a designer, not necessarily an architect, but I consider him part of the discipline, obviously, of the creative arts, to introduce this duty of vision as a concept in his TED talk he gave in 2007 called Design and Destiny. And I thought it was a very good way to start discussing a little bit this vision and the potential spatial and conceptual implications. Also, I think his accent is slightly worse than mine, so it makes me look a little bit better. Anyhow, let's listen to this, please.
It's so fresh. And there is something. Nobody is obliged to be a genius, but everybody is obliged to participate. And to participate for a mutant, there is a minimum of exercise, minimum of sport, we can say. The first, if you want, there is so many, but one which is very easy to do is the duty of vision. I can explain you. I shall try. If you walk like that, it's okay. It's okay. You can walk. But perhaps because you walk with the eyes like that, you will not see, there is a hole. And you will fall and you will die. Dangerous. That's why perhaps you will try to have this angle of vision. Okay, I can see if there is something. Up, up. And I continue. Up, 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 up. I raise the angle of vision. But it's still very selfish. Selfish, egoist. Yes, selfish. You survive. It's okay. If you raise the level of your eyes a little more, I see you. Oh my God, you are here. How are you? I can help you. I can design for you a new toothbrush, new toilet brush, something like that. I live in society. I live in community. It's okay. That starts to be to be, you start to be in the territory of intelligence, we can say, from this level, and more you will rise this angle of view, more you will be important for the society. More you will rise, more you will be important for the civilization. More you will rise to see far and high like that, more you will be important for the story of our mutation. That means intelligent people are in this angle, that it's intelligence. From this to here, that it's a genius. Ptolemy, Eratosthenes, Einstein, things like that. Nobody is obliged to be a genius. It's better, but nobody. Take care in this training to be a good mutant. There is some danger. There is some trap. One trap is the vertical, because at the vertical of us, if you look like that, oh my God, there is God. Oh God, God is a trap. God is the answer when we don't know the answer. That means when your brain is not enough big, when you don't understand, oh my God, oh, it's God, and that is ridiculous. That's why jump this and come back like that. No, not jump, come back. Because after there is another trap. If you look like that, you look to the past, or you look inside, if you are very flexible, inside yourself, it's called schizophrenia, and you are dead also. That's why every morning, now, because you are good mutant, you will raise your angle of view. Out more of the horizontal, you are in intelligence. Never forget. Like that. It's very, very, very important.
4 billion years. And he says it was impossible, obviously, for those very basic biological entities to imagine what we could be right now. So it's impossible for us to imagine what we might be in 4 billion times. Anyhow, but I thought that I was going to use this diagram to explain these particular angles of visions that he just introduced. To say that actually this kind of, there's a particular relationship between mutation and schizophrenia that he describes. And with the different angles of views that I think in architecture are all being looked at from at all the points, and that for, you know, it's kind of, there's not a clear trajectory always towards intelligence. And we'll try to explain it. In fact, the different angles, you know, it's kind of that are on the left, which seem to be propelling humanity more towards the future, and the ones at the back. And I must say, I don't totally agree that looking at the past is a total schizophrenic condition. I always like to say that both a Fiat Panda, let's say a very cheap car, or a Maserati or Lamborghini, they both have rear mirrors, because I think, you know, wherever you drive, even forward, on the streets and a highway and so on, you still need to know what's happening behind in order, you know, not to cause incidents and accidents and so on and so forth. But anyhow, I think it's quite important. In architecture, if you look down, as he explained, and you're dead, in a totally unconscious about design or about social implications, then architecture is like this, right? There's also a very particular, there's a very large domain within architecture and design which is very selfish. It's only driven by economic means, you know, by developers. It's really not research. It's just about making buildings and making profit out of it. Very selfish, not very intelligent. Then we move by raising the angle into architecture as being okay, as I said, like you can design, like he's a designer, so he compared his toothbrush and a lemon squeezer, like in London, for instance, you know, kind of a well-designed Olympic Park in the east of London. Obviously, it's got problematics and problems with communities and so on and so forth. But never, it's not just, you know, economically driven project also thinks about society. So it's okay. And then we move into the intelligent bracket, where architecture becomes more intelligent, relevant to society, is part of cultural production, and produces buildings that are more just buildings. They also become relevant to civilization, so they become really part of history. And also they become part of future histories and of mutation. To use Philip Stark's work, like for instance, Frank Gehry, where he used or he had to adapt CATIA or particular software and transfer that into the architectural domain in order to make those buildings. Then we look at the genius side. I think there's very little, and not to offend anyone, I thought I use an old example, Borromini, Baroque, the Baroque church in Rome, San Carlo, where I think it's an absolute splendid manifestation of architectural and design of tectonic virtuosity, almost geniality. And then he mentioned the trap of God, and if you probably know about God, and kind of things, so I don't want to go into religion, but I still think it's something quite interesting to look at, not in political terms, but in purely architectural design terms. One might argue that God actually has been the best client in the history of architecture, if you look at mosque, cathedral, and so on and so forth. So, you know, I would rather be cautious with totally and disregarding him. And then we look at the past, which to Philip is a schizophrenic endeavor. I partly disagree with that. If you look at 1952, we still find the future there. So these are random magazine covers from 64 years ago, exactly the same brackets as if you look ahead to 2080. Computation was also there in its embryonic shape, but nevertheless, it was already part of history. And in architecture, buildings were built, you know, kind of which then became symbols of, you know, high architecture like Le Corbusier and other particular projects. Interestingly, just looking at 1952, that didn't really give me a lot of material to, you know, explore or extrapolate the potential future examples. So it's more one is actually more successful if one looks more at almost 100 years of history, like the 20s. There was a more visionary decade for architecture, one might say, like with movies and Le Corbusier and futurism and those kind of stylistic agendas. Or maybe even 10 years later, in the 60s, where again, there was a very strong visionary, urban, societal, driven architectural endeavor to reboot architecture and to rediscover it. So the 50s, in that sense, were not, I thought, from superficial research, extremely interesting. So maybe 2080 is actually not very good. We might be looking at 2090 as a potential more interesting place for London. And then again, the total schizophrenic, if, as Philip describes, when you're very flexible and you manage to put your head into your own backside and you're absolutely, totally delusional and not aware of what's happening, then architecture contributes absolutely nothing to that. And these are problems in the world that we have. We're here to also to discuss megamalls, and with all respect, I don't know who delivered this image, but I don't think this is the proper image to, I guess, advertise a megamall in London in 2080. It's maybe a designed, nice piece of architecture, but it's actually not contemporary already in 2016. So I'd rather go back to 1952. And so I would state that perhaps London as a city will be a mega mall in 2080. And interestingly, this is what Walt Disney did in 1952, where he established Walt Disney Engineering, Imagineering, actually, which is a good term. And that's, I think it's a preliminary master plan of Disney World or Disneyland, whatever it's called. And I think that's actually more contemporary or more adequate to describe a megamall in London than this particular image. So it's not going to be a building for sure, but it's going to be urban, complex, artificial, semi-controlled, potentially more controlled environment. And then I did, I thought I wasn't gonna do it because the time was very short, but on the side I tried to do some photoshopped images to show what 28 might be, because people asked for a visual interpretation. And so I think, you know, this control, if I can go back, pardon me to, no, I won't. But anyhow, it kind of in the 1960s, there was this project of Buckminster Fuller of the dome over Manhattan. That's potentially something that might happen. Doesn't need to be built. It could actually be produced and with other means. Again, just these are not very good images, just like illustrations where I just photoshopped some of my drawings and onto London, just to ask questions. Maybe a few buildings might look differently, and hopefully some of these things might be capitalized and drawn and built, and potentially, hopefully, architecture and cities won't look like they look right now. I'm quite adamant and I'm quite hopeful that the vocabulary of architecture will enlarge in the next 64 years. And I think that's really, you know, kind of have a mission is obviously probably to advocate for a richer vocabulary, both in aesthetic terms as well as in technological and other terms than we have right now. And then I found this book on my shelf, which was called Futuristic, where we had been asked to contribute a couple of years ago, and where we were asked to give, I think, a list of 100 words or whatever about what we might think that the future is. And we just gave an ABC of a vocabulary that we would like architecture to be capable of incorporating in the future. So like augmented, and with this I will show student work done here at the Bartlett and in Innsbruck and some of our own work. So an augmented architecture, so not static, dead materiality, potentially biotechnological architecture, like in this example of a gazebo that we built here in London into 2012, where it's built in nature, but it also built nature 2.0 through photobioreactors. It might be convoluted, complexity, form surely won't be a problem, also not in design, not in fabrication, might be digital, which is something I've been researching for a decade or more, hopefully experiential, so architecture is not just, or will hopefully not be just service providing, but a space that people, or specialities that people may want to acquire and experience. Figural, so ornamentation might not be, you know, what still under the modernist tenets. It might be gelatinous, which means architecture that only materializes in the right environment, like here, this particular material that only hardens in specific temperatures. Might be hybrid, which means artificial, partly natural, partly manufactured, partly grown. In lucent, so materiality, hopefully, might be more interesting and seducing than, for instance, this particular room. It's like jelly-like, soft, variable, dynamic, kaleidoscopic, again, materiality, not dead, but reactive and responsive to the environment and atmospheric conditions. Latent, which means that it might have either technological or biological or whatever it might be, intelligence that can be emergent at particular point of time. Mutant, so architecture that could be enclosed, furry or porous on demand. Neoplasmatic, a research by my teaching and office partner, Marcus Cruz. Ornamental, again, kind of not as boring and pale and stale as we know it. Also poetic, it might allow us to discover spaces separated from a super frantic and busy urban environment, all very quirky and very busy themselves. Robotic, of course, I'm not gonna show these movies. Maybe soft, again, kind of more intelligent, responsive, reactive to particular conditions. 3.5 dimensional, which means not only shape, but also capable of changing and mutating. Unpredictable, responding to local or global conditions, perhaps driven by data, on demand, real time, voluptuous or seductive, whimsical also, why not? But hopefully exuberant, another kind of research have been done. An EP might be happy that some things happen. Or zealous, so really hardworking also to work with or against high urbanization or agricultural politics and so on and so forth. But whatever it is, I just wanted to end with this image. I think we as a discipline, as a community, we have to grow certainly in order to take care of our cities and our buildings and also, but not to leave them like in Lego as an illustration of what the city is actually, but still to consider them as growing organism and with all the potential, you know, technological and environmental, whatever, conditions that the future might bring. Okay, I think I'm going to stop it here, 20 minutes. Thank you very much. Yeah. And then I'll do what I, okay. San Diego, it's your turn now.
My chief AV problem will probably be staying the right distance from the mic, so.
Still don't have the mic. Talk again?
Okay. How about that?
Are we live now here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay, so correct me if that goes wrong. Okay, am I audible, properly audible? Huh. How about now?
Test. Hold on 1 second.
Fine at the send.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. The notes for my talk actually are online, and you can see them at the bottom.
Can you hear well?
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, testing. How about that?
Okay. We can hear you well at this end.
Good, thank you. So, the notes for my talk are online, and you can see them at the bottom of the screen there, the URL. I'll probably not get through all these notes, but that's fine. That's how I planned it to begin with. Sheldon pointed out about the singularity and the conflict with the timeline that is ostensibly the timeline of this of these talks. That's fine. I'm happy, more than happy to speculate about things before the singularity. And furthermore, as Marjan said, no one can predict the future. And I think the right way to look at the future is with scenarios, which the whole centerpiece of science fiction, of course, is thinking about scenarios. With scenarios, you plot out an internally logical vision, often of a very extreme situation. Having a lot of scenarios at your disposal is very important, since you are probably going to have to live in the future, and thinking about the scenarios beforehand gives you a step up in terms of identifying where things are going. So in that sense, thinking about the future is actually very interesting and very important. And the particular scenario that I'm playing along with here is that the singularity does not happen, at least in the near future, and that we are, however, in a future with continuing massive disruptive changes going on, often and largely from technological reasons. In that situation, I think that there's some changes in the way that people look at thinking about how to do things in the world, and I can see two or three very important principles that might arise. One, we already have plenty of evidence of, and that is that substituting software for physical solutions is often a big win. Of course, that's not always possible, but something that's very closely related is the idea of using software to specify physical solutions. And that is fairly mainstream now, and I think will become more and more popular. Putting those two together, I think we have something that is related to the way I'm using the term late binding. In computer science, binding time is the point in time where you attach your symbols to objects. And I think that fits with thinking about technological implementations. And the principle that I see here that is important is to design for late binding, and that is that there's a virtue in designing so that irrevocable decisions can be postponed until the last possible instant. This should appeal to procrastinators everywhere. I see two tools that I want to talk about mainly today for achieving this, especially within domains of architecture. One is augmented design, and the other is the Internet of Things. When I say augmented reality, I mean something that's a little bit different from the virtual reality that we see now, especially the implementations that we see. First of all, I don't want it to be intrusive. I would rather not have a helmet that has to wrap around my head. Eyeglasses are about the most extreme modification that I want to have visible to the outside world. But within the domain of eyeglasses and contact lenses, and I'm not up to this, up to implantables, but some people might be, implantables within the eye, one can imagine being able to see the universe outside yourself for what the way we see it now, but also using the help of computation and networks and knowing where the wearer is looking at any given time, we can overlay those portions of reality with what the user wants to see, or the important things about reality that the user with their naked eyes cannot see. That was a scenario in my novel Rainbow's End, where wearable computers were the natural interface with the Internet of Things, in the same way that PCs and desktop computers have been the interface with the classical internet. There are certain sort of physical properties that your display must have, and that there's certain sorts of computational properties that must be supported. So for instance, you need to be, as I said, you need to be able to know exactly where you're looking, and the display that overlays that portion of your visual field with whatever else you want to see has to be very precisely centered, and it has to remain in position as you look away. In order to do this, in order to get this knowledge, really you need at least some basic support from the Internet of Things. Normally nowadays, when we talk about the Internet of Things, people are talking about computers that are in lamps, computers that are in thermostats, embedded processors that have some connection with the internet. This that I'm talking about is a little bit more flexible than that. For instance, most of the nodes that I'm talking about that are networked would not be associated with any particular larger device. They would just sit in the environment. There are certain properties, minimum properties, that we would want them to have. They should know where they are at. They should be able to communicate with one another. In fact, that may be central to figuring out where they are at. And they should have some sort of sensor suite aboard them, cameras or anything else that humans might want to use in order to know what they're looking at in the environment. There's one other thing that such nodes would probably have, at least as we go forward in future, and that is effectors, that is ways of changing the environment. For the basic augmented reality scenario, I don't see that as really necessary, so I'll postpone talking about that for a few minutes. Using this basic AR, there's some interesting things that we can do. It's pretty much compatible with the Internet of Things as we have right now. We need a scattering of such nodes in the environment. But if we had such a scattering with cameras, we could do things like have visual synthesis done in real time. So for instance, if you were designing a building and you have a wall here, if you wanted that wall instead to be a window for the user, you could just declare it a window. And I don't mean a window in the sense of a super big LCD display. In fact, the super big LCD display makers of the world are probably headed for hard economic times in the world that I'm envisaging. Instead, the visual information of this window is provided as the overlay that I was talking about, but the information is from cameras all around, cameras that are on our side of the wall, cameras that are on the other side of the wall, or wherever the other side of that window is supposed to be looking out upon. And as you move your head around and walk around toward the window, your display, or that is not your display, your vision of what you're seeing through the window moves seamlessly as it would if you were looking at a real window. So three-dimensional television is sort of just a throwaway that comes along with this. Once you have that, you have something that's very interesting for individual users. But what makes it significant from an architectural standpoint, it seems to me, is that if we had a lot of people in the room, if they chose to agree that this is a window looking out into the square beside Atkinson's Hall here, they would participate in that consensual reality. So each of them would be able to look through that window. But their wearable and their eye augmented reality would show it from their point of view. So from the standpoint of the people in this room that choose to participate in this consensual reality, we now have a room with a very large window here. You can extend this to all sorts of aspects of the shared reality. We can choose whatever wallpaper we want. We can choose whatever visual appearance we want for the lining on these chairs. That actually was a central feature of Rainbow's End, and it seems to me that it comes rather naturally with this form of augmented reality. Also imagine in that situation something that I call congruent spaces. For instance, there could be an auditorium at the Bartlett that has the same dimensions as this auditorium at UCSD, and perhaps the same layout of chairs. That means that for a meeting like this, we could all be here just sitting around. Of course, if the overlays were extraordinarily good, we might want to have some tag on our epaulets that indicates whether we're really there or not. Larger congruent spaces or multiple congruent spaces would be more difficult to handle, but are very interesting. For instance, you could have a high-class mall in New York City that could have congruent spaces with malls elsewhere in the world. So when you go to the mall, your local mall, you actually can walk around in the mall that's at either in New York City or some other fashion center, London, and you could actually see things that are like there. And maybe this would give them a step up over what the classic online sales have been in the early 21st century. I want to move forward a little bit from that into what would be like if our Internet of Things becomes more competent and material science, which is marching on and which I haven't said much about up till now, but which I think is very important. Material science gives us properties for things, for real physical things. So what I'm going to be talking about here is stuff that you could do in virtual reality for prototyping. But for the most part, I want to talk about things that we could actually do that have physical reality that are supported by the augmented reality where necessary. And one of the biggest features that we have in this sort of scenario, following on off the pure augmented reality scenario, is the notion of effectors related to the Internet of Things. In some cases, the affected objects might be very large, big machines that do things, but really, individual nodes that themselves have rather small effectors, if there's enough of them in the environment, they can do extraordinary things. They can have the effect of doing very large things. Again, I'm assuming that they coordinate with one another and that there is design intelligence distributed throughout them and that they coordinate with the people that is in the environment. If you have this sort of situation, then in very easy way, you have things like movable walls and doors and interior artifacts, all per the needs of the current consensus that the users have. You could also have acoustic management in the sense of signal processing running in a distributed form with thousands and thousands of tiny effectors. So for instance, nowadays and in the future, material science has given us things that are very, very strong, usually very, very light, to the point where the few times that I've run into them, they look almost flimsy until you try to break them or stretch them or do something that's not within their specification. If you had the sort of sound manipulation that I'm talking about with the Internet of Things, those super materials could be part of your movable walls. However, they would not have this sort of flimsy appearance that super materials have nowadays. If you got near them, they would sound to your, if you had a good hearing for echoes and things like that, they would sound very, very strong and very deep and dense and classical. And if you tapped on them, they might sound like deep stone. Now, there are other ways that such an Internet of Things can be used, of course. For instance, disaster defense. Right now, we have in architecture now, and actually going back 60 years or so, we have disaster defense built into buildings in the sense of earthquake defense and storm defense and big weights that shift around in tall buildings automatically. This can certainly would be extended in this future. This brings us to an interesting analog with what we see in aeronautics. In the last 10 or 20 years, the idea of making aircraft that are inherently unstable has moved out of the domain of insanity into the domain of practicality in certain areas. For instance, certain aircraft can achieve very high maneuverability at the price of being unstable, to the point where if their computer systems go down, the actuators that are driven by the computer system, if they go down for a few milliseconds, the aircraft is in an uncontrollable failure mode. Do we want this for buildings? Well, I'm not sure I ever wanted it for aircraft, and we have it now. The thing would be to think about what are the things about buildings that could benefit that we can't get nowadays because we're so intent on making sure that that by themselves they do not fall down. I find this very scary. And I go back being scared about these things for a long way. I can remember as a child seeing in automobiles little buttons you could press that would make the window go up or go down. And I thought, well, that's a cool idea, but I sure as hell will never buy an automobile that does not have a backup, that is a little wheel that I can turn that will roll the window down and roll the window up if I need it. And here I am since almost forever, with power windows that do not have little backups. This is a situation that I can see in the scenario I'm talking about getting worse and worse. And it ultimately puts it in a position that I say there where the physical world may take on the solid dependability that nowadays we associate with financial markets. But that's not all. That's not where it ends. As we go forward, I think the concept of distinguishing between the Internet of Things and the materials that make buildings, that will merge. And so we'll have this merging of material science, metamaterials, and the Internet of Things. So in that situation, we have multiple components that are ever smaller in size, say down to the sub-centimeter size, and with perhaps a few hundred different species of motils capable of assuming all sorts of different lattice configurations with varying physical and computational properties, all with design knowledge and informational knowledge that's distributed through the environment. This makes very late binding possible. The building can add to itself in real time per the thought and intention of the inhabitants. It might even purchase property and build new parts for itself. Marjan's vision of a London-wide mall becomes something that would be a design problem that solved in software could be implemented as fast as you could convince people that it was a fun idea, and dismantled as fast as the people could convince you that it was not a fun idea. It's interesting to consider in this new era what buildings and cityscapes would look like when you compare the richest part of the world with the poorest parts of the world. And I think that's especially appropriate in thinking about these things and going forward into the future. It seems to me that one scenario would be that we'd see something that is an extension of the success that we've had with consumer electronics. If this worked out, then we would find that both the rich and the poor parts of the world would have access to most of the same best designs. That's software again, software constructs. Both the rich and the, but a little bit more extraordinarily, both the rich and the poor parts of the world might have access to most of the same smart building materials. In fact, it could well be that the price of those building materials, not zero, but comparable to the price of packing, the relative price of packaging materials are in our world. One big difference that I see between the rich and the poor parts of the world, even in this fantastical scenario, is that the poor parts of the world would probably not have anywhere near the accessible power resources that the rich parts of the world have. Putting these three factors together gives the possibility that if you were to look at the rich parts of the world and the poor parts of the world, unlike the shanty town, terrible slums that we saw in some of the that you see all around us in parts of the world now, that the rich parts of the world and the poor parts of the world might not look that different. The poor parts of the world, because of power accessible power differences, might be less fast changing, and they might need to be more spread out, and handling their interfaces with the outside world, with the rest of the world, might be more difficult. But some very, very nice things could be possible. I think, in fact, the biggest barrier to these will be us as a society and as a human race solving the problems of peace and war and tolerance and all these social issues. That will be the biggest discriminant for whether the differences between the richest and the poorest become closer and whether they both look very, very wonderful. Thank you. There's more on this list, but I will leave that to anybody who wants to look at it in on the internet file I specified.
Now we have time for you two to have a little chat before we throw it open to the group as a whole.
Hello, thank you.
Hi. Thanks for the talk. So, do we?
Okay, so it's us now.
Several of these issues before, Marjan, and I was taken by the Philippe Stark video and also the diagram that you drew. And I think this notion of having different angles of gaze that corresponds to the immediacy or the visionary degree of the person is very interesting. I think I only had a couple, I did have a couple comments or variations on it. One was to point out that, or to make the comment that one wonderful thing about modern society is that we can support and make use of all sorts of angles of gaze in terms of the very practical people, so practical that they really can't do very much else besides think of practical things, up to the visionaries. In our present era, we're in a situation where one wonderful thing about society is that there's a place for all of those. They can benefit and survive, and so can the rest of society.
Oh, absolutely. That's why I wanted to show it also.
Because I think it's got this intrinsic schizophrenia, the diagram itself, that, you know, it's quite difficult to focus just on one of these particular angles, I would say. Especially in education, I would say, right? If you educate young architects, I would say, I think you have to, you teach them to have like the 360 degree vision of the world, because it's not purely a technological endeavor, and it's not only about the user. It's also surely about, you know, kind of, as I mentioned, the cultural production as well. Kind of, if you, you know, kind of just bringing it back to example of this, the shared the window, like the digital window you were describing, kind of where you can actually, if the community accepts that that's a window and then you see what's on the outside, surely one wants to know what's on the outside as well, right? How, what's that environment? And does it gaze back at you? And in a sense, so, you know, it's kind of one of the difficulties that I can see as a designer, that the somehow architecture will always lag behind the technological possibilities that that actually we have at our disposal. First of all, I think it's to do with the acceptance of people, I would say, because that diagram, if you apply it to the user, to the people as well, so there's very few people that probably go into that, that fall into that particular gaze geometry. And so the users, but also those that, you know, at some point have the, you know, the power to, you know, as a, to define what it's possible or not. You know, it's kind of architecture is still embedded, you know, within laws, legislations, norms, and all of those things that are very, very difficult to change. So the acceptance is not just, it's just, you know, to bring it back to that scenario. I think the minor difficulty I see is the acceptance of the users within the room to accept it as a window. It's more, does the society, the general, you know, kind of the larger community agree that that is a, you know, kind of, it's an acceptable way of designing a window.
Would be made to, and what sort of social customs would arise if that sort of technology were around. One thing that I speculate is that, first of all, if you get a scenario as extreme as the one that I was talking about, you really are in a situation where reality becomes something that is defined, and you could imagine a situation where the definition of reality became something that was subject to legislative control. There's a joke that you probably, a lot of people here have heard about a legislative body that decided that the number pi was inconveniently complicated. So they redefined it as 3 1/7 as a matter of law. That law did not survive for very long. Because it ran up against the fact that what pi stands for is something that is not 3 1/7. But in the universe where technology takes off and becomes distributed in a very fine-grained way, you could imagine that something like legislating reality could happen. And in that case, you could imagine particular legislative domains where particular sorts of technology were just prevented from happening, which is very actually, in the large, that's easy to do. In the small, there's cheaters that could always be around, worming their way around in the walls. But yeah, the window depends on the agreement of not just the people in the room, but also larger, more widespread populations.
Sure, because the magic doesn't work.
Who do you call? The technician? The, you know, the architect, the designer, the electronic guy. Well, it's interesting, but something else. I think I was really interested by this notion of the late binding. You also mentioned when we talked that I think it's quite timely to architecture as well and to design processes where suppose there's a transition from a top-down approach of planning things, you know, towards a bottom-up approach of a collaborative, transdisciplinary approach of sharing data and, you know, kind of real-time feedback between the disciplines to create a system, you know, rather than a plan. So a flexible, pliable, elastic, you might call it parametric, whatever, this system, so that it can respond to a whole plethora of, you know, degrees of complexity and variations that both legislation as well as other aspects might bring. So I think, you know, it's kind of postponing, not the decision making, but somehow postponing the, it's actually more postponing until, you know, bringing it back to legislation, until somebody or something needs to be an object that can be fixated as being the delivery of that particular building or city, right? And that late binding, I think it's happening right now. So it's really interesting. So it's not that far in the future. Right? Kind of, there's a, kind of, if you think about BIM, you know, to talk it in very common sense, and it's kind of this aspect that there's a file or there's a system where so many the architects and the engineers and contribute, which raises questions of authorship and also of course, responsibility, you know, and so that's mandatory for public buildings in the UK. I think it's this certainly this trajectory towards postponing somehow the freezing of a design of architecture, and I think it's quite interesting. I think kind of it's not. I think it's happening right now. So that's certainly one of those predictions that. Taking over. Whether it makes architecture more flexible afterwards, I probably don't think so. Because, as I said, at some point the system needs to be frozen right now, because insurance companies want that in particular, and the client, so that the responsibilities are then very clear. So I wonder, you know, kind of whether that late, you know, kind of how much, you know, how much that actually will contribute to. For dynamic architecture, as you describe, you know, in not only as a vision, but as a real commodity. But it certainly has become more complicated in a sense that architecture has to be more intelligent, has to be cheaper, has to be is procured differently. It's not monumental in that sense that it has to last physically, but it probably has to last as an investment. As well, quite fast returns, but it has to be sustainable at the same time as well. So the thing going back to, so I'm not really sure whether timing has changed dramatically in the last 60 years. It always takes about 4 to 5 years to deliver a fairly sized building. Unfortunately, kind of the, I would say that the most interesting buildings in architectural history are those that took much longer and were over budget. But this is a very well-known secret. Utzon's Opera House, one of them, for example. But at some point, I think they can be or they have to be forgiven because it has a social sustainability that it's difficult and a cultural sustainability that's quite difficult to put into numbers. And in the cathedrals, I think one of the common agreement is actually that it's impossible to build a Gothic cathedral nowadays without the aid of machines, without the aid of computation, of robotics, and so on and so forth. And so there's a definitely a reinvention of crafts, you know, it's kind of cathedral in that sense, were not built by architects or designed by architects, but by master craftsmen. And there was a different setup for the delivery of those buildings. But I think the implementation of technology is necessary to achieve that, which I think is quite interesting. So we've lost the capability of creating those shapes, partly to think about those morphologies, but certainly also to deliver them. And now I think with the digital and the post-digital, there's this aim to rediscover through digital or computational crafts, you know, kind of the possibilities to, you know, to achieve that virtuosity again. And so just to bounce a question back to you is kind of what I would say most of the, in the last three decades, especially in digital architecture, has been very widely discussed is this concept of multiplicity, which maybe sounds as being in contrast to your singularity, right? In a sense that we use machines, so we would like to think about the aid of technologies in fabrication and design and all these various processes of architecture as a way to expand, right, to enlarge, to have multiplicitous shapes and delivery methods and assembly protocols and so on and so forth. Whether those processes will take over and then actually, you know, turn back into singularity, as it might have happened in the future, it's very possible. But how do you feel that? Do you think we are still in a process of expanding our interfacing with technology towards multiplicity before, you know, your envisioned scenario, or is it do you already seeing a trajectory that is, you know, focusing and bundling towards and converging towards that particular event?
So when I think of these malls, I think of why does anybody come out of their house in the future, since with 3D printing and with personalization and with such excellent VR, we really don't need to go shopping in any way outside of the house. And likely, when you went to the mall, if you were going to get products, you could try them on. But of course, you could try them on at home because they'll be reusable and you'll be able to digest whatever the material was that it was made from and reprint it again. But you would certainly not carry it. You'd get it back at home. So if the goals, I mean, the nature of production is so different, then it's fundamentally social that people are and experiential that they're coming out. And that's what you see with the development of cinema and so on, where they so often it's been predicted that cinema will go away, and then it gets resurrected, and now you have dinner there, and you have these comfy couches, and so many different ways that it's happening. It's all experiential and social. So I wonder if you guys would like to just say a couple of words about the opportunities of the future that are going to open up in virtue of that.
And then
Bruno,
pass it anywhere.
You go first.
Okay, so the ball has been passed back to San Diego for that. I have a lighthearted non-answer to the question. And I wrote
Rainbow's End. This is a story about a person from 2013 who, because he's an Alzheimer's, he's a recovering Alzheimer's patient. And in 2025, he's like a guy who's come from the past because he doesn't remember the last 10 or 15 years. And he's learning all about these wonderful things about augmented reality and some of the things I've been talking about here today. And one day he's driving along in his car, his automatic car, of course. And he looks out and he's driving north on Highway 5 here in San Diego, and he looks out and he sees a shopping mall. At least that's what the augmentation says, you know, the label, the marquee on, that the augmentation provides him, is that this huge building is a shopping mall. And he thinks to himself, geez, after everything I've seen here in this modern, wonderful world that we have nowadays, what would they actually be doing in a shopping mall? Namely, David's question. And then he thinks to himself, you know, sometime I'm going to have to take my car over there and go into one of the shopping malls and see what it's all about. And you can read that whole book, and he never does. Which is sort of a confession, an implicit confession on the part of the author to a non-answer.
That's a good question. I mean, usually it happens the other way around. No? They predicted that with internet, you know, you would be able to go to places and you don't have to travel. What happened actually, you know, kind of with cheap airlines and the DIY kind of travel agents, you know, kind of that you do, that you have become yourself. People travel more than ever, right? It's become cheaper. Mobility is much more obvious and part of society, you know, the society than predicted. So I guess the fact that, you know, through internet or whatever, you can, you know, drones, all these kind of things, that you might never leave home, I think is, I must say, it's a scary scenario and possibly something to really think about, because which means that aspect of comfort change, right? So if you really enslaved, or if you spend so much time in a room, whatever the room means, then surely that needs to be designed in such a way that it doesn't become a prison or a tomb or something, you know, kind of very claustrophobic and psychologically damaging. And I suppose that there's even if the technological and the whole delivery methods of products, whether the physical or whether they're, you know, kind of even just through uploads, whether that happens, I still think that, you know, the body won't change so dramatically. You know, cyborg, yes, and implants and prosthetics and
augmentation happens, but maybe it's my humanistic education, but to somehow think about an easy way to not think about the necessity, the physiological necessities and psychological as well, of a body is quite difficult. And I think that space, you know, kind of perspective and all of those things that perhaps can be simulated, you know, perfectly, I guess that there will still be a underlying need for tactility. I don't know how to describe it, right? And I suppose the kind of it's quite interesting, also like with internet, e-books. But so, you know, I think libraries still and books are still being sold and books are still being produced. And maybe it's, you might not read it, just smell the pages as well as I do.
Right.
Again, there's this physical, kind of commodity that probably, maybe my generation probably, maybe it's an aspect of education, I don't know. But I don't believe that, you know, kind of going out, won't be an option.
No, I'm sure that it will be great. And
Could I add one thing to that?
Please.
And that is, I agree that the I agree that the socialization angle and the being with other people angle is the strongest argument for what might could go on in the mall. I also agree, and I think Marjan was kind of going in that direction, that there's this question of what happens when the technology gets good enough so that the experience is as good as being there in the mall. What would be the reason for going them all? And I think that if there is an extreme version of that, there is a scenario for that that is fairly unsettling, but has been worked out in extraordinary detail, and that is the book, The Age of M, nonfiction book by an economics professor, Robin Hanson. It's going to be published by Oxford University Press on the 1st of June, and I really recommend that for an extreme, extreme view of what this sort of situation would be like if there was nothing that was worth actually walking out to participate in.
Yeah, and maybe I could ask a question too along these lines. What I thought was one of the points that I thought was quite compelling is when Vernor, you were discussing this kind of consensual reality that was made manifest by people agreeing that this particular thing should appear to be this other particular thing. And so perhaps that's something that is the provocation of engaging out into the public commons in these future scenarios so that we can actually have a touchstone on a kind of communal touchstone on what might actually constitute the consensual reality of any moment to moment. So engaging with others in public space, you know, raises the stakes of what is considered to be the real or not the real. And in this, and within this scenario, it kind of raises some really interesting, troubling concerns. If I kind of think about what constitutes the mega mall of today, you know, it's essentially Amazon and Google and Apple. You know, those are the mega malls of our time. And so if these software affordances, you know, kind of pick up your late binding call to construct our next version of our physical reality, your call for what might actually legislate the kind of decisions about the kind of social contracts and relationship to here. Is our legislation of this for a public good going to be woefully behind the capitalistic monopolistic interests of a few corporate actors who seek to monetize every aspect of our own individual behavior within this kind of mega mall of the future to their own self-interest? So how is that tension between who defines, who owns this reality, and our own kind of, you know, a willingness to be the ultimate commodity of these future commercial spaces?
Marjan, you want to do first? Do you want me to do first?
Sure, you go first.
I think that one thing about what you're saying, Sheldon, would be reflected by individual jurisdictions, that you'd have a you could have a patchwork that might be even more extreme than now. For instance, you don't want to go to that part of Pasadena because the world is such and such there, you know, much more extreme than you want to put up with. The Canadian science fiction writer Carl Schrader has written several remarkable novels about worlds like that, and the conflicts. Short of violence, the conflicts are still very strifeful because you can imagine how different the levels of technology that are allowed would be from one place to another and how different the attitudes about that would be. And then I'm personally convinced that it would be possible to cheat. So you'd have people that would essentially have magical powers because they were importing powers that they should not have in the local jurisdiction. And of course, if they're caught, they might be in serious trouble.
So there's a level of interleaving of different types of engagements with these
right.
kinds of realities.
I made a pocket career out of the zones of thought, which was an interstellar adventure story. But I think we may confront different zones of reality here on Earth long before interstellar adventures make it possible.
That's a difficult question. I mean, going back to the window consensus scenario, I was just wondering, you might, I don't know, if we agree that there's a window, then is it a purely democratic process that the majority might, you know, want to see London rather than the Maldives, let's say? Is it actually a common denominator, which means, you know, meeting in the middle in a mediocre understanding of what might be seen through the window? Or is it driven by fantasy and by ideas and by visions and by unexpected scenarios? So they might actually, you know, one of us might come up with an idea of what we might look through the window that's not being predicted by the system or by the legislator or by the technologist and so on. So how do you deal actually with the unexpected? Or how do you deal is that, you know, that potentially it might be not an option that is not being computed, which means it's not a prosthetic device, you know, it's not here to augment our possibilities, but it's actually a frustrating castration device. And I think there's always this danger. That's why I think that the scenario of, this concept of consensus is really interesting, but it's quite tricky. I think it goes into a political, social domain that raises very many questions of options. You know, it's kind of probably easier to vote when you've got one or two options, or even less, as you have over there at this very moment. or, you know, whether it's not about options, but it's about the creation of options that actually don't exist. So I don't know what a meta option is, and I suppose that's quite difficult to describe in technological terms, also in architectural terms, because then, you know, there's psychology that plays a role and so on and so forth. So it's complicated, and I don't remember what the question really was. Sorry.
Well, I think that I don't know how to pronounce that. You know who I'm talking about. Asked a really important question when you had brought up the window, and that connects back to the gaze, the rising of the gaze, which he asked, but does it gaze back? So you're creating a reality, but everybody's still a spectator. So it's like a spectator consciousness because, yes, you could look out the window and see London or the Maldives, but they don't see you. There could be an animal, a bird, a person, whatever is happening. So the gazing back also connects to this idea, well, why would you go to the wall, to the mall, to the mega mall? That you have some kind of exchange connection, dialogue, whether it's, you know, visual or audio. So it seems to me that what might be more likely to happen when you talk about singularity and physical material, and also the singularity of the organic human being connecting with the implants, the technology, the cyber post-human, is that there's going to be some things happening as they are now. If anything, if there's any trend now, it's that these things are all happening at once. Yes, we have e-books and we go to the library. We're doing both. So it might not move, converge in one of those directions. It might just simply be ever expanding. So you can be a little more hopeful to think about it that way, that one or the other is not going to dominate as we change, evolve, mutate.
Yeah, I certainly agree that the possibility of coexistence of these different types of technology at the same time, reading books with paper and reading books in an e-book, that's among the most likely of the possibilities, no matter which scenario works out. It would take a rather rigid tyranny to force everybody into one usage pattern. And I think it's a good thing that we'll have a bunch of different usage patterns.
I have a question from London. Can you hear us?
Yes.
So just in terms of scenarios to both of you, when we talk about what's left over if we advance into the future, I just wanted to put this thought forward to you. At the moment, we use virtual reality, film, videos, you know, all this other media and computation as a form of escaping what we are or where we are at the moment. And I was just thinking, in the future, if we become so dependent on all of those virtual aspects, do we escape back to reality as a way of coming out of the virtual? So that's, it's almost like a cycle, you know, the whole going to the seaside in Brighton as opposed to going to the virtual Grand Canyons or something like that. Will there become more of a need for the tactile and the real in the future because of the fact that we're moving so fast away from that? So that's one thought. And then the other one is, in terms of we as human beings mutating, if we become so dependent on everything being a virtual and internet and linked to us, as in coming to us, then there's that physical aspect of we as people. Do we become fat and, you know, without any legs and become a whole case of diabetics and cardiac cases that eventually need the exercise in order to maintain lifestyle or to maintain physique as well? So that's another thought.
Sure, I think that's the inevitability of the body, right?
Yeah.
And gravity, I think, we won't overrule that easily, I would suppose. I mean, some time ago, if you remember, during this whole migration crisis, you know, it's kind of, there was this particular photograph of this child, human child thing on the beach, mm-hmm. that made it around the world, I think, you know, definitely here. And some of there was, I saw on Italian TV by chance, there was conversation, and they had like Italian famous photographer Oliviero Toscani who commented on that and said like how bizarre, but actually it's quite, you know, it's paradigmatic in a sense that it's a photograph that becomes this, you know, kind of symbol and icon for a whole political, global, at least in Europe, you know, kind of crisis. And it's not, you know, all the media and all the collected data that, you know, you can have like through mobile phones and obviously GPS and all of that and the whole, you know, all television broadcasters were there and so on and so forth. It's a static image that captures society's imagination. And I suppose it's quite interesting, and I might describe, you know, somehow this feeling that surely if everything is dynamic, everything is virtual and everything is uploadable, there will be still the counter argument that it might be a monument, it might be a solid piece of rock or something quite physical that actually captures the imagination. and maybe becomes a historic moment in the history of civilization of humanity, rather than all this super amount of big data and visual and information that happens. I think that it's quite, I just think it's quite interesting, and it's easily to come to, I think, to exponentially digress that 2D image into a 3D object, right? Talk about architecture.
I wrote a book. I wrote a book once called Marooned in Real Time, or Across Real Time, and it takes place 50 million years from now. Humanity is not around anymore, except for a few time travelers. And it raises an interesting question. How much do we want to be remembered beyond the era that we're talking about? We're talking about a century from now, or 80 years, or 64 years from now. How much do we want to be remembered beyond that? In a way, that is one of the strongest purviews of architecture, that is the monument, what gets seen further down in time. And as my characters in Marooned in Real Time noted, they knew very little about the last eras of humanity, because the last eras of humanity had gone so strongly over for the sorts of things we're talking about here today. So I think there probably is some scope, if one has any interest in there being a human echo down through the eons of time in long-term physical structures.
Well, I'd like to thank everybody. Thank you, Werner. Thank you, Marjan. I've had a great time. I hope everyone else has, and we'll do this again next year. But thank you for a wonderful event today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So from the UK to the US, 10 points. It's Eurovision.
And just to mention for the Clarke Center, we have an event coming up in a week and a half on Octavia Butler. And so check our website. It's a multi-day event. Check our website for the details of aspects of that that are open to the public. And hope some of you can join us for that. So thanks. Thanks, Werner.